good morning, Trevor, and a very warm welcome to you. It's a pleasure to be talking to you. How are you, sir?
I'm very well today, thanks. How are you?
I'm very good. I'm very good. Well, main part of the interview is going to be talking about your 15 minutes of fame on that great program, The Chase. Yeah? But before we get there, we'll do a quick fire answer question answer session. Yeah?
Go for it.
Right. What's your favorite food?
I like all food. I don't really have a favorite.
Well, that's good then. Have you got a favorite film?
Favorite film is probably Pulp Fiction from 1993, Quentin Tarantino.
What about the most famous person you've sort of met or come across in your life?
Probably our late Queen, when I was 10 years old, she drove past me within about 10 feet when I was in Billingham, as I used to live in Billingham. And she'd just opened the Billingham Forum and she drove past and she was waving. I like to think she was waving at me.
I've got no doubt she was. She thought, there's a man for the future. Yeah. So, what do you do, or did you do as a day job?
I was a general manager working in the chemicals industry, and I was involved in the remediation of redundant high hazard chemical facilities, which meant that I travelled extensively around the world and I actually needed two passports.
Two passports.
Two passports, because certain countries, if you go to, say, Israel, well, you can't go into Israel with the same passport as you want to, if you want to go to Saudi Arabia or Qatar or Emirates or Oman. They don't allow it. So I had to have two passports because of restrictions, access restrictions, and also visa requirements. A lot of countries still need visas, so needed two passports. But sometimes it'll take 3 or 4 weeks to get a visa.
Yeah. Obviously, you had to be organized for doing that because you pick up the wrong passport. You get a bit stuck at the other end, don't you?
Would be in
Yeah.
trouble.
Favorite sport?
I don't really have a favourite sport, unless you regard horse racing as a sport.
Well, is horse racing not a sport?
It's an industry, it's a business, but it's people bet on it. But I wouldn't call it a sport as such. I don't. It's not like football or rugby or cricket. It's horse racing to me is not a sport. It's just something I like indulging in. And I actually own 5% of two horses.
All right, so that, which hoof is that, by the
Which what?
hoof.
Hoof. It's probably its left forelock.
Now, this brings us to the main event because obviously, famous person now, you had your 15 minutes of fame on a program called The Chase.
Yes.
How did that come about?
Well, I retired in 2017 and I started to watch too much television. And one of the programs that I got into was The Chase, and I did rather well always. I could get 8 or 9 questions. I could always shout at the television and say they were idiots for getting questions wrong. So I applied, and that was in 2017. Had to wait 2 years until I got an audition in 2019. Passed the audition. And then I had to wait another 2 years until the 30th of November 2021 before I actually appeared on the programme. And then, of course, it was another sort of 13 months after that before the show actually got broadcast.
So you held this as a secret for all that time that you were there.
Yeah, one of the things when you sign up to join the Chase, you have to agree to numerous terms and conditions to do with confidentiality, to do with health and safety aspects, to do with disclaimers, waivers, all sorts of things. There's about I must have signed about at least six documents before I was allowed to go on, and one of them was confidentiality. So you're not allowed to tell anyone that you're going on until 2 weeks beforehand.
So obviously you were a great fan from the sofa in front of the TV.
Yeah.
Doing really well.
Yeah.
How did you do on the show for those who didn't watch it?
For those that didn't watch it, I managed to get 6 in the cash builder. That's the first part of the quiz. And I should really have got probably 8, but I got my Cluedo question wrong, quite badly wrong. And then in the when I went up to the chaser, who was Paul Sinner, the cinnamon, he was very, very good, and I was awful, but I managed to scrape through by the skin of my teeth. And the four of us took him on one at a time. 3 of us got through. 1 lady got knocked out, unfortunately. So there were 3 of us in the final chase. And again, I got some silly questions wrong. I froze up. I had a mental block with Kenneth Williams. There was a question about Carry On films, and the answer was Kenneth Williams. So I pressed the button, said Kenneth, and then my mind just froze. I just couldn't get. So we ended up in the final chase, only scoring 14, which is clearly no good at all. But Paul Sinner is an absolute genius when it comes to general knowledge. And we would have needed 21, 22 to actually stand any chance of beating him, which was almost impossible. But yeah, it was good experience. Interesting fact is that they get 500,000 applications every year for that program, 500,000. And so even though we didn't win any money, at the end of the show, they said, well, you're all winners, really, because you're one of the very few, very, very, very small percentage of people that can actually say you've been on the chase.
Right. So obviously, audition, you've been there, got the T-shirt now.
Yeah. Got a water bottle.
Yeah.
No T-shirt, no photographs, just the water bottle.
And that's it. They didn't even give you a copy of this on a DVD or anything like that.
Nothing like that. It was a surprise to me, because I thought going to the studios, it would be glamorous, but it isn't. They're very, very businesslike. The actual show, whilst it lasts, I think, 44 minutes on the television, it took us 2.25 hours to actually film it, because they have numerous stops and starts. When they edit it together, it's seamless, but at the time, you're stopping and starting every few minutes. And the other interesting fact was I had to take 5 changes of clothes. Everyone did, because what they do is they take your clothes out, and they screen test your clothes. So they have 4 people stood there holding your clothes up for the camera to make sure that none of them clash. And then, of course, because you've traveled down overnight, they then take your clothes away to press them. So they press the clothes and they give you them back and they say, right, you're right to wear this. But the other interesting thing is that they put sweat pads underneath your armpits. I don't know whether that's something I've... I shouldn't be saying or not, but they do. They put sweat pads because clearly they don't want these great, because it is quite warm and you're nervous. So you don't want people sweating while you're on television. So that was quite an experience. And the first and only time I've ever had sweat pads fitted.
Now, I hope you haven't signed one of those documents that say that you can't give that information away, mate.
I don't know. I don't know whether I can. It's too late now, isn't it?
Yeah. So have you any plans for going on to... but doing something similar with any other quiz programs?
I would love to try and get on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Now, I applied for that also in 2017 when I retired. But so far, the phone hasn't rung for that one. So my guess is that I'm probably going to have to reapply, because it's a very popular program. And in many ways, it's probably a bit easier than The Chase, because you haven't got the time restrictions that you've got on The Chase. The problem with The Chase is you're conscious of the fact when you've got a minute, and that minute just whizzes past. So on Millionaire, you've got more of a chance to sit there and ponder and think about it and look at Jeremy Clarkson.
I don't think he'd object to you looking at him.
I hope not. No, I admire Jeremy Clarkson in many respects. He's quite entertaining.
Now, obviously, the difference between sitting on a sofa at home is you haven't got the pressure of the TV lights, the cameras, everything like this. So you're more relaxed. And as you say, being on the show, it's a time constraint.
It is.
So what's that experience really like? It's
nerve-wracking. It's absolutely nerve-wracking because you know that you're the focus of attention for probably several million people are going to be watching it. And you are trying your hardest to be as quick as you can, but actually that can work against you because you're not listening necessarily to all of the questions as they come out. So you sometimes, if you get one wrong, you sometimes miss the start of the next question. So I think I should have done better than six, which is the score I got. I should have got seven, possibly eight. But I wouldn't dream again of a giddy height of 10, which is very, very unusual. I'd have to be some sort of really clever person to do that. But I still watch the programme. I still enjoy it. I've got it on. I've recorded it. I've watched it a few times since and analysed my performance, which could be better. But, you know, you can always say that about most things in life, can't you?
Very, very much so. Hindsight's a great thing, isn't it? It's but saying that, the odds, realistically, for winning, if there's four people against one, the odds have got to be greater than one person against one.
But they give you a very, very thorough briefing beforehand. It takes about just under 2 hours before you go in front of the cameras. So that 2 hours, they go through in great detail what's going to happen because they don't want anything to go wrong. And the statistics they give are, I think from memory, if there are four people through, then there's about a 50% chance of winning. If there's three, that drops to 30%. If there's two, it drops to 20%. And if there's one, I can't remember. I think it's only about 5% ever get through if there's one. So it's very difficult. If you haven't got a full team, which we didn't have, unfortunately, it makes it that much harder because that one step can make a huge difference. Plus the knowledge that person has. You know, the lady that got knocked out would have known things that I didn't know.
Now, obviously, with those kind of odds and everything like this, you would automatically assume that everybody who was on there would go for the middle ground, whatever their prize money was.
Yeah.
Because the idea would be, obviously, the more you have, the greater chance you have. Doesn't work that way, does it?
No, it doesn't. I mean, people are always reluctant to go low. And in our case, we had 17,000 with after three of us. And then Viv went on and she scored four. She was offered minus five to get one step closer. Now, we all said to her, oh, no, go with the four. Whereas, in fact, the correct thing to do would have been minus five, because if she'd got through, that might have made a difference to the final chase. And the statistics that they throw at you about the percentages, that you forget about those because that huge drop in going from 17,000 to 12,000 seems like a lot of money, but at the end of the day, we didn't get anything anyway. So it might have been better for her in hindsight to go for the minus five and come back and give us one extra step against a very, very good chaser.
Now, that's one thing about these chasers. This is their day job.
Oh, they're very, very, very good. Yeah. I don't know how they can hold, retain, and then regurgitate all of that random knowledge that they've got. I mean, Paul Sinner is incredibly good. I mean, he beat us. He got 14 with 52 seconds to spare. I mean, that's a rate of knots. And like I said earlier, we'd have needed 21, 22 to put them under any sort of pressure. And we were never going to do that.
No, but like we say, it's his day job. So he's got used to the fact that he listens to it, answers it, whereas the competitors listen to it, think about it, then answer it.
That's true. They tell you to listen carefully to the question, and you know there was one question that I got wrong, which was to do with Ash Gray, and I didn't listen to the beginning of the question properly because Brad had actually said, "Well, what whitish colour is ash. And I said white as the answer, and it's actually ash grey. And it's because I didn't listen to the question properly. But again, this time pressure, that's what it does to you.
Now, I've watched the programme, right? And I was impressed with the fact that you came up with the Roman numerals for 99.
Well, many years ago, when I was 16, 17, I did A-level Latin. So I managed to just remember the pattern, the sequence that the Roman numerals it's a very strange way that they have of doing their arithmetic with the Roman numerals. I just about managed to remember that. So yeah, that was quite fortunate that one came up.
Yeah, because that was very impressive, because actually two of the answers came to 99.
Yes, correct. Yes.
Yeah. So you got the right one.
I picked the right one, and I was that was part of the problem. If you recall, the Paul Sinner also took probably about 7 or 8 seconds to think about it, the same as I did. So it puzzled him as well, because both answers, there were two answers that came to 99 on it. But there was only one correct answer, and I managed to get it, and so did he, unfortunately.
A big tick there. You're obviously listening to that particular lesson while at school.
Yeah, I must have done. Not much else, though.
Listen, on that note, it's been a pleasure talking to you.
It's been great.
What we will do, we will end with just a few questions just to round it off.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
What's been your best holiday?
Holiday?
Yeah, favourite holiday.
Well, I tend not to go on holidays overseas. I tend to go in the UK. So I would say probably... trip down to Stonehenge. That was great because there's so many Neolithic monuments in that area. So I think I spent about 4 or 5 days just going around cairns and henges and stone circles, and it was brilliant. I enjoyed that, and some good beer down there as well in Wiltshire.
Now, obviously, one thing that most people don't know about you: any hidden talents?
Hidden talents? I don't think I've got any hidden talent. I'm a perfectly ordinary person that tries to do his best generally. I do try and remember useless bits of information, but I have no hidden talents other than I used to enjoy drinking a lot of beer, and I used to be very good at identifying different beers and going to beer festivals. That was quite a talent, I suppose, to be able to identify different beers just from their tastes and not look at the barrel.
A very enjoyable one at that. And have you got a proud moment, something that you really look back and think, wow, yeah, pleased I did that?
The sense that when my firstborn was, he was born at 23 and a half weeks. So I was quite proud of that. But it was quite a distressing time because he spent the first 3 months of his life in hospital. But I was quite proud of that moment because I'd finally managed to pass my genes on and actually do my job, so to speak.
Now, you've mentioned beer festivals, so I'm assuming this one should be an easy one. A favourite drink?
Oh, it's beer, obviously. And the favourite beer that I drink is actually a Welsh beer. And it comes from a very small brewery in Port Maddock called Purple Moose. And the beer is called Snowdonia Ale. And I came across that one in Jersey when I went to the Jersey Beer Festival many, many years ago. And excellent beer, and I've yet to have a beer that surpasses that. So a good pint of Purple Moose Snowdonia Ale, favourite drink.
On that note, Trevor, it has been a real pleasure chatting to you.
Yep, it's been a pleasure talking to you as always, Rob. You look after yourself.
And when we meet up, I'm after your autograph. Because now I can put you on the list of famous people that I've met.
I'll charge you a tenner and it'll go towards the festival.
That sounds good to me. Yeah. Thank you very much, Trevor.
Thank you, Rob. Thanks a lot.